Hello and welcome to AK Souffle. And as you can see today, I'm being a fairy at the bottom of the garden. But it's a very specific garden, the garden famous for fairies, if you're prepared to use the word in terms of homosexuality. But this is Charleston Farmhouse and it's very, very beautiful. I've been going there for over 31 years and I've watched as it has had a renaissance. And I'm delighted to be joined in the studio today. Let's go to the studio. Hooray! I'm joined in the studio by Mark Richardson. Mark, thank you for coming in.
That's fine. That's
now, you're one of the new members of the team out at Charleston, and your role is?
Community Engagement Officer.
What does that exactly mean?
Well, it means that Charleston's got a particular type of audience that's been going there for a long time. It tends to be the same type of audience.
What is that audience?
Middle class and white. And what they want to do is to open the door to more diverse audiences. So I've been brought in to start that process.
Now, previously, you've worked at Carousel here in Brighton, which is an organisation, an arts organisation working with people with different abilities.
Yes, that's correct.
Differing abilities, I think, is the polite way of saying it these days.
Yes, indeed, yeah.
And I like that phrase. Yeah. And I've been a big fan of Carousel for a long time, and also for Grace Eyre.
That's right,
another organisation I've been a fan of for a long time.
Yeah.
So it's a different move. You're working in a different field now.
Yeah, very different.
Is it exciting to be moving to something
this? It is, yeah. I mean, you know, getting to my time of life and changing career almost completely is a very exciting thing to do. So, yeah, I'm looking forward to the challenge ahead.
How aware were you of the Bloomsbury Group before you went there?
I've always been aware of the Bloomsbury Group. There was the programme on the television, of course, and one of my friends...
The dramatisation, which I thought was very poor.
Yes, it's not a great dramatisation.
It's not, is it?
No, I don't think it's very good.
I thought the recreation of some of the rooms was very good.
Yes.
Because they weren't allowed to film in the farmhouse.
No.
For obvious reasons. Mm. So the recreations of the rooms, but I actually thought plot wise it was lame.
It was lame and it was very poorly shot, I thought. It wasn't a piece of television that kept me entertained for very long. In fact, I think I saw the end of it.
I don't think I finished. Mm. I think I watched two episodes and gave up because it didn't represent the story that I know.
No.
And the story of the Bloomsbury Group is extraordinary because they were so ahead of their time.
Absolutely.
And I want to go and talk about that more so. But currently, the farmhouse is seeing another stage of its renaissance with the opening of the new barn and a new gallery. What's happening there?
Well, the old barn that's been there for a long time and used to host performances with the leaky roof and the very dodgy electrics needed refurbishment. So they applied to the Heritage Lottery Fund for some funding and they had a 3-4-year-long project called the Centenary Project. And as a result of that, they've built a new barn, which is a 200-seater auditorium. They built a new
Is it on the side of the old barn?
Yes. And they basically rebuilt the barn. So they've got in some excellent craftsmen from the area to rebuild it in the way that it was originally built.
So it still fits comfortably into the structure of the place.
Yes, absolutely. And next to that, they've got a new cafe. So the other barn that was derelict, and in fact, I think almost non-existent, is the new cafe. So at last, there's going to be a cafe where you haven't got to squeeze yourself into a pokey room. And then in the courtyard to that, they've built 4 new gallery spaces, which are incredible, you know, really kind of cutting-edge architecture, but still fitting in very nicely with the barns themselves and with the surrounding countryside.
And appropriately cutting-edge, because the Bloomsburys were cutting-edge at the time.
Weren't they?
I mean, they were really out there.
Yeah.
They were doing things that other artists hadn't really dared
Absolutely.
To do.
Absolutely, yeah.
I was fascinated. I went to the Queer Art Britain exhibit.
Tate Britain.
Which was extraordinary and it was wonderful to see some of the very homoerotic work that had come out of the Bloomsbury groups there. Mm. And I think one of the things that has over the years been somewhat guarded is the homoerotic work of those painters and writers.
Yeah, absolutely. I think so as well. I mean, I think one of the things about Bloomsbury is that it has a very queer heritage. It's kind of embroiled in the whole nature of the group and of their artwork, but perhaps is not celebrated as much as it could be by the museum itself, perhaps, and by also the visitors who come to see it. And I think that gives us an opportunity as we move into a new phase of Charleston to really big up the queer voice and let that itself inform the future development of the museum and of the artists there.
Do you think it's partly possible because we are far more accepting of queer history now? And do you think in the past they were guarded against it because it might have put people off going
yeah,
there.
Yeah, I think so. And also I think that the museum's changed as well. You know, it's kind of been run by different people in different ways. And in the past, it has been a little bit more guarded about how it talks about its heritage and about the promiscuity there. Whereas now, it's much easier for us to talk about those things in the wider context of what's going on in Britain at the moment.
Well, you used the word promiscuity, and it's one of the things that fascinates me about them, because I've read quite a lot about them over the years. And what always amazes me is that they were, how would I put it? They weren't sexually ambiguous, they were sexually adventurous.
Yeah, absolutely.
And promiscuity was a key to it. They were leaping in and out of bed with each other in all manner of combinations. And I don't know whether they went in for threesomes.
Well, who knows? They may well have done.
Yes. But there were certainly men sleeping with men, women sleeping with women, men sleeping with women, and so forth.
Yeah.
There was nothing that they didn't touch.
No.
Do you think they were helped by the fact that Charleston is, and was back then, of course, fairly isolated?
Absolutely. I mean, it's in the middle of nowhere. Essentially, what the Bloomsbury Group did there was create their own community, and they could do whatever they liked there. And they did.
Yes. I mean, they sort of revelled in it, and they revelled in it in their work as well. Mm. In the writings, there are stories that are very strongly homoerotic.
Yep.
The paintings particularly, and particularly Duncan Grant's work.
He was an
admirer of the male form.
Indeed. Indeed he was.
And represented it very, very beautifully.
Absolutely. Some lovely work at Charleston. Really lovely work in the museum. And in the new exhibition as well, there will be more work unearthed.
So are you constantly finding new work?
Well, there's a lot of work out there. Recently the famous women dinner plates have been rediscovered, and they're coming to Charleston and will be exhibited in one of the new galleries as part of the kind of the new launch of the building. So yeah, things are being found regularly. There was the Angelica Garnett gift just a few years ago.
Yes.
They unearthed a whole load of different sort of sketchbooks and letters and work that was previously unknown and that's being kind of catalogued now and will gradually come out into the public eye as time goes on and opportunity allows.
There's a lot of work in private collections as well, I know.
There is.
And one of the greatest collectors is, in fact, Brian Ferry.
Yes, unbelievable.
Yes.
Yeah.
And he's got quite a number, but he's also very, very good and loans them to the farmhouse.
Yes, he has. He has. Lots of exhibits get loaned to the farmhouse and are kind of regularly changed in the rooms that people look around at Charleston. But also some are going to be in the galleries as well as they launch.
And you also loan a lot of works to exhibits around.
Yes.
Not only the UK, around the world.
No, at the moment there's one in Sweden. There's a museum in Sweden that's recreated the Bloomsbury set, the Charleston House, in their museum with work loaned from Charleston. And it's quite interesting to see photos of it because it looks familiar, but yet not.
Not quite right.
Yeah, yeah.
Do you have a problem when things are on loan with visitors and they walk in and they're wanting to see something which is a well-known work? And there's a little sticker. I always think when I go to the Tate or to the National, and there's a little sticker that says, on loan to Sweden. And you think, I want to see that.
I want to see it, yes. Yes, well, I think the thing about the house is that a lot of the rooms have a range of different artwork in there. So when one's on loan, it's replaced by another.
You can move another in.
Exactly, yeah. Nice. And that keeps people happy too.
And of course, the whole building is a work of art because
Indeed.
It's completely covered in paintings.
Yeah.
How difficult is it to maintain that when you have footfall of visitors?
Yeah.
I mean, you're hoping to attract more people to the farmhouse, but
indeed.
With a higher footfall, that problem is going to increase.
It is. This is a hard thing. There's a team of people whose job it is to make sure that the house is maintained. And it's a challenging job because a lot of the art is on fabric or, as you say, on furniture, and very difficult to make sure that it stays, if you like, uninfected by people's curiosity. It's very easy when you go to a museum, and we're used to it, to go in and touch things and kind of look at things. And in Charleston, that's a hard thing to do. You can't do it because you're actually touching the art.
One of the things is that because it's a farmhouse, it's not very big.
Yes.
So the red ropes are not really There are not.
I mean, what you get at Charleston is people kind of politely reminding you not to try to touch anything. But you're right, it's hard sometimes not to touch something as you go by it. You brush alongside something.
Yeah. Mm. I love it there, and I can't wait to come out. And in the second half of the programme, I'm going to talk to you about the forthcoming exhibition, because I think that's very exciting.
Yes.
And we'll talk a little bit about how you are appealing to that new audience, what you're actually doing to get to those people, apart from coming on my show.
Of course.
But for now, that's all. We'll see you after these ads, and we can talk a little more about the saucy goings-on at Charleston Farmhouse and the Bloomsbury Group. I'm sure they got up to an awful lot more than we can read about in the books. I have to talk to Dr. Clark about that.
Dr. Clark will know all of that.
I think he's written it all down, hasn't he?
I think he probably has, yeah. He's the author.
Hello and welcome back to AK Soufflé. I'm joined today by Mark Richardson from Charleston Farmhouse Trust. It is a trust, isn't it?
It's a trust. It's indeed a trust. A charity and a trust.
A charity and a trust.
Mm-hmm.
Now, let's talk about the new gallery, because the forthcoming exhibition, I think, is going to be very exciting. And I know one of the artists that is exhibiting is a firm favourite of mine. That's Matt Smith, whose work is extraordinary.
Yep.
And beautiful.
Absolutely.
And I'm very proudly an owner of a very big piece of his work. I love it. How many pieces is he showing?
I don't know for sure. I'm not party to everything that goes on there. Some of it's just going to be unveiled. But he's one of the featured artists in the new galleries.
And who else would be exhibiting?
Who else? Well, basically, it takes the whole exhibition takes as its starting point Orlando by Virginia Woolf, another member of the Bloomsbury Group. And it kind of celebrates the fact that we're now 90 years on from the publication of that book. And one of the themes of Orlando is gender fluidity.
Yes.
And the fact that the central character changes sex several times. So, you know, in modern day language, a trans person. What the exhibition's doing is kind of taking that as a starting point, showing some of the work from the Bloomsbury Group, but also kind of contemporizing it, if that's even a word, with some other artists who do work that kind of have a modern day take on Orlando and what happened there. So yeah, we've got, as you say, Matt Smith. We've got Zanelli Mahuli, who is fantastic artist. We've got some great photographs of lesbian and trans people who are black from around the world in striking poses, kind of floor to ceiling photographs, which are incredible. We've also got Kay Donaghy and Paul Kindersley, who's done a couple of installations, great films, and then Delaine Labasse. So a good cross-section.
This is a major show, isn't it?
It's a major show, yeah. It's a major gallery.
Well, it is now, isn't it? Mm. This is going to be a very important part of the Sussex arts scene.
Yes.
Are you hindered, though, by the isolation? I mean, how easy is it for people to get to you without a car?
Yes, that is the challenge. That is certainly a challenge. There is no public transport that gets really anywhere near Charleston unless you're somebody who's very into hiking, in which case you can get to a train station and walk across the fields on public footways or the South Downs.
Which in the summer is quite nice.
But in the winter is not.
And in terms of when it's open, I mean, do you have a closed season?
We don't anymore. We're going with the new galleries.
That's a big change,
isn't
it?
It's a big change. There's going to be a winter opening. So it's reduced hours, but the gallery itself will be open 10 to 5 from Wednesday through to Sunday. So there will be some very interesting stuff to
see. That is a big difference, because I know I've had friends visiting me from abroad who've come in the winter and said, we really want to go to Charleston, we want to see the Bloomsbury farmhouse. Yeah. And I said, it's not open. Yeah. I mean, I'm lucky because I know people, so maybe we could sneak in.
Yeah.
But for the general public, that is really good news.
Yes, it's great news. So, as I say, it's reduced opening hours for the house, because winter is traditionally time where the staff...
The conservation team.
Absolutely. They get some dedicated time to make sure that things are preserved appropriately. So it's a kind of limited hours to enable that to happen. And also, not all of the rooms will be open to the public because of the conservation that's going on.
Will it provide a much-needed revenue stream?
Yes, Charleston is one of the museums that in the country that income generates. We don't get any funding from any public bodies. So the money that's taken on the door goes straight back into the museum to keep it open.
That's quite a responsibility, isn't it? And I'm assuming that you can't actually earn enough money from door fees.
No, not quite.
Let alone keep it going in that sense, but to staff it, because there's quite a large staff out there.
There's a large staff team, definitely, There's, I think all in all, if you count everybody, there's around about 50, 60 people out there working, when you take into account the guides who show everybody around the house and tell the stories of the Bloomsbury Group, and then all the other people who are kind of making sure the mechanism of the museum rolls forward.
I think people aren't aware of how difficult it is to actually run a museum of that kind, because it is, I mean, although it's small, it's a stately home.
It is.
Or a stately homo. And behind the scenes, there's an awful lot that has to go on.
Yeah.
I mean, even if it's only administering the insurance of the artworks and the structure.
Yeah.
And those sort of things.
Absolutely.
And I think people are unaware of
Of
that. And are you very volunteer dependent?
We are. We have a great team of volunteers who work with us to support the guests to go around the house and to also make sure that the outreach work that we do and the projects that happen with other members of the community can happen. So without them, I don't think Charleston would survive.
Part of your role is community engagement. Are you taking Charleston out to schools?
Well, Charleston is going out to schools and it's developing kind of outreach to the local schools and working with families and young people. Indeed, it is doing all those things. But the key job that I'm doing is kind of reaching out more to the lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, queer communities to encourage more of a queer voice in the way that Charleston is operated and programmed and developed. So one of the things I'm doing to start off with is I'm running a project called Unexpected Delights, which we're recruiting to at the moment. And it's open to anybody who wants to come along who identifies as queer and to engage with us and find what in the museum and the surrounding garden and countryside and galleries gives them an unexpected delight. And with that unexpected delight, we're going to take some photographs, write some words and create a zine that's going to be available for people to take away at the Small Wonder Festival, which is at Charleston at the end of September.
I must come out and do that.
Absolutely.
If anyone wanted to do that, how should they get in touch with you?
Get in touch with me. My email address is m.richardson@charleston.org.uk. So that's a good way to get in touch with me. And I can send you information about that. We have a little group building. And what I'm excited about is that that project will kind of start a process that could lead to a focus group of queer people who are interested in making sure the museum carries forward with the heritage that it has in a kind of maybe more open and transparent way than it has in the past.
Well, as you've noticed coming into the building today, we at the latest group CIC are very involved in queer heritage with our new exhibit Live and Let Live outside, and we are charting the changes in Brighton and Hove's gay cultural scene since the 1950s, although focusing on the 70s, 80s and into the millennia. And it would be really good, actually, if we could share with you some of the work that we're doing.
Yes,
because
absolutely.
I think it actually has a very strong influence on what's going on.
Yeah.
I wonder if they actually came down to Sussex because there was a reputation of this being a rather louche place to come to.
It could well be. I mean, obviously, I don't know exactly why they came to Sussex. I know they came because they wanted to find somewhere in the First World War or before the First World War to make sure that they could not fight. And by coming to the countryside and working on a farm, they were kind of like immune from conscription. So that's how it began.
Oh, clever.
Very clever.
And
very
cheeky.
Clever. Very cheeky. Something I'd be looking at, though, I think, if I was
absolutely
around.
I'd be out there ploughing fields rather than going ploughing trenches.
Or shooting guns.
Ugh. Oh, yeah, no, not to do that. Do you have an artist in residence at Charleston?
We don't have an artist in residence as such, but we do, as we kind of show from the exhibitions, feature work. And we do have artists that come and work on some of the groups that we kind of like run there. So, for example, David Lilly comes along and runs the painted coloured glass workshops yes. there. And other people do similar things. There's quite a range of workshops that go on at Charleston. I know it's a museum and people come to see the heritage of the Bloom group, but one of the things that Charleston's very strongly into is making sure that art continues to be available to people and that people have a chance to continue to develop their arts experiences and their arts lives. Some of the work that we do there is income generating for the museum. So if you look at the programme at Charleston, things are quite expensive. But my role is to generate or make other projects for people who don't have quite so much money to make sure that they can taste some of the Charleston magic.
I think that's a really important thing moving forward within the arts community, that although some of us can afford to go off and do these expensive seminars, events and things like that, that actually they are fairly exclusive.
Oh, yes.
So to see an opening up of that, and particularly one that's going to appeal to the queer community. Yeah. I love using the word queer. I don't care what anyone else says.
It's one of my favourite words too.
I think we're very happily queer. It's good fun.
Yeah.
Listen, when does Small Wonder start?
Small Wonder starts right at the end of September, the 28th.
And how long does that run for?
That's just 3 days this year. It's been reduced because it's been quite hard to find funding with, you know, everything that's going on in the world at the moment and reduction in funding. It's kind of reduced because of that. But I think it's reduced and kind of polished off the edges a bit and perhaps is a kind of more sexier festival for that reduction.
Well, I'm sure all the viewers will love a sexy festival. That's all out at Charleston Farmhouse, which you can find if you travel out of Brighton on the Lewis Bypass. Yep. And it's just past... it's Firle.
Firle. It's in Firle.
It's in Firle. Yeah. In fact, it's more or less the only thing in Firle.
I think probably, yes.
The only thing of real value.
Yes.
Thank you so much for coming in, Mark. It's been lovely talking
been a pleasure.
To you. And thank you for watching AK Soufflé. We'll see you again next week. Bye.